Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here, still in North Carolina for a few more days. Hope you guys are doing all right. Been real busy. Getting ready to send back the van. Gonna meet this sister here in another place and pass off the van, and then I'll be driving the RV temporarily as the Lord will make a way. For all things to come together. You know, it happens to all of us, brothers and sisters. And I say this in my videos all the time. You know, the Lord would use our own personal experiences, you know, as an example. So when I start talking about the things that I'm doing and then mention, you know, related to the Word of God, it's so we have examples, brothers and sisters. So I wanted to give you another example, something that the Lord's been showing me. Those of you who've been following my videos, you know what I'm talking about, but so I'll just briefly say this. I'm a conservative, and maybe even a libertarian as far as that goes. I believe in the Constitution and all that is, you know, there's only one higher authority than the Constitution, and that, of course, is the Lord. So I would follow the Constitution and let people have freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and all that, only to the point of, them infringing on my right to serve the Lord and all that. And my freedom of speech, you know, everything, brothers and sisters. But anyway, as a conservative person, and I've mentioned this before, so I'm just saying this again for people who didn't see my videos. I'm pro-capitalism, too. I'm pro-people having wealth and all that. And up until the time when I came back here to the States in August of last year, 2013, I would say that I was very, very pro-wealth. And I've mentioned in videos in the past, brothers and sisters, and I talk about the things I ran into. For me personally, brothers and sisters, now, you know, I say this and put myself out there, even though I know there are people who are not children of God, as the biggest thing I've learned as a pastor in 14 years, as far as dealing with people, you can give someone your personal testimony or say something like that. There's always someone that will try to, you know, use it against you. I'm sure that you guys who are Christians for a long time have experienced that. Those of you who are new Christians, you have to be careful who you share, your problems with. You start talking to people about your problems, they'll turn around and they can make it public and, try to use it against you in a negative way. So we have to be careful of those things, brothers and sisters. You have to be careful who you share with. There are people you can share with, people you can't. And, that's just a matter of discernment or, you know, the Lord is the one to lead us. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that being said, I would say all but one of the wealthy people I personally worked with and encountered and know personally, all but one couple, they all had similar problems to a certain degree. And that's why, you know, it reminds me of what the Lord said, it's easier to fit a camel through the eye of a needle than the rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, and then he said, you know, and then his disciples said, well, if this be the case, how can anybody go to heaven? And Jesus said, you know, with man things are impossible, but with God all things are possible. So, and no, that's urban legend about the entrance there in the wall of Jerusalem that a camel could kneel down and go through called the eye of the needle. That is a urban myth or a legend. That is not true. That's something someone made up. It's a pretty cool story, but it's not a true story. So Jesus literally was talking about through the eye of a sewing needle, which is a small thing. So in other words, as an example, if someone tried to use that false mythology about how a camel can get down its knees and fit through the eye of a needle in the wall of Jerusalem, then that is something that's possible. If the camel gets on its knees and you gently lead it through and take off its backpack, it could do it. But Jesus was making the point that it was impossible, something that's an impossibility. So fitting a camel through the eye of a sewing needle is an impossibility, other than some miracle from God. And that's what Jesus was saying. Becoming a born-again Christian and entering the kingdom of heaven is a miracle that only God can do. That's the point. But anyway, I want to tell you guys a story, and I've got several videos to make. And this is a story that the Lord had given me that's tied to this. And the Lord has been, you know, and especially if you're in a prophetic like me, a prophetic ministry, like in the Bible, the prophets, they had experiences, and then God would use that as a lesson, like, Jeremiah went and looked at the potter's clay, and then, you know, God is saying he's the potter and we are the clay. And then that's a, you know, a metaphor that God uses in the Bible. And then lots of different things. You know, Jeremiah bought some property before the children of Israel went into captivity, the final destruction of Jerusalem, to show that people would come back, that there would be a remnant that would come back and get the land. So it wasn't going to be gone forever. So he bought a piece of land to show that, you know, people, the Israelites, would still inherit their land. Anyhow, for me, brothers and sisters, the Lord, you know, when the day after I got the RV back, you know, the RV, I'm driving the RV because I don't, you know, I don't have anything else to drive. It's not really safe for children, small children, because you have to have them in a car seat. So, you know, it's not safe. As a matter of fact, the law, you know, this RV has one rear seat in the middle of it, but it's on a wooden mount. And by law, you can't actually put the car seat connected to a wooden mount. So I probably have to put my son in the front seat in the car seat beside me, because the seat has to be attached by, you know, metal and securely, according to the law, I guess, of all states, but definitely North Carolina, where I'm at. It's probably nationwide. But anyway, it's not safe. An RV is not really safe for kids, and it's not very safest thing to drive either, because it's so big and you can run over somebody in the parking lot or back into a car pretty easy. You have to be very, it's tedious to drive it. That being said, brothers and sisters, God has made a way for me to have it and drive it until the Lord will provide something better, which I know He will, as He has promised me. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so the day after I got the RV, I'd already been looking on Craigslist every day since I found out I had to get back the van. So, brothers and sisters, the Lord really led me to go look at these two vehicles in one day. Even though I already had the RV, the Lord still led me to go look at these two vehicles. I didn't know why. So I called each people, and so I could come over. So I went to one. I went to these back-to-back, brothers and sisters. I went to the first one, and it was the place I went to. The guy, he has the biggest house in the whole area where I went. I don't know if it's the biggest house and how big of an area. It's like it looks like the White House. As a matter of fact, that's what he calls it, the White House, because it looks about like the White House. It's a very big house, the biggest house in the subdivision on a private neighborhood on a golf course and all this stuff. And there's nothing wrong with that, you know. I met the guy. And to start with, this, just to mention it, it's like a 2005 Chrysler Grand, Chrysler Town and Country Limited. And he was asking $9,000 for it. So I'd messaged the guy before I went, and I said, hey, I'll give you the private sale Kelly Blue Book value. Okay, so I looked that up myself, and then just given it a very good rating, not excellent, but a very good rating. It's like $7,100. So I went to see the guy, and I told him that, and he said, well, I can't take a penny less than $8,000. Okay, so I'm at the guy's house, brothers and sisters, outside, and I was there about 2 hours, and I only spoke like one sentence in 2 hours. This guy talked to me for 2 hours. Now, what the guy said, you know, the only line I got to get out was what I just said about, well, you know, the price is, the Kelly Blue Book is $7,134. And that's very good condition. Not necessarily his isn't very good. It's probably more one step below that. So about $7,000 was about right. For 2 hours, brothers and sisters, he proceeded to tell me how he owned 60 are 59 stores in a chain of pharmacies here in the United States. I'm not going to say which one. It's a national chain. He owns 59 stores. Only one person owns more stores than him. And it's a famous retired football player. He was telling me about that. And he's telling me that, you know, he's ashamed of the minivan. Don't want to drive it. They only use it to take his children to college. And his youngest child just graduated from Duke University Law School. All three of his children graduated from Duke University Law School. There's nothing wrong with that. This guy was in his 50s, brothers and sisters. And for 2 hours, if I'd have met this guy walking down the street and the guy was telling me what he was telling me, I would say, this guy's insane. He's a liar. This guy's not all, he don't have all that he's saying he's got. Because the guy was bragging like a 16-year-old that just got a new Corvette. This guy was in his 50s. He was telling me all about how if he's got one of his children that wants a $1,500 Prada pocketbook, he has to buy all three one. If they want 1,000 pair of Louis Vuitton shoes, he has to buy all three a pair. But that's nothing to him. It's nothing to him. He's loaded. with millions. And if he and I told him, I said, well, you know, I'm a missionary in the Philippines. I came back to the States. I'm looking for a vehicle because I'm driving around to visit people. I've got these orphanages. I got out that line, just about what I said. So about 10, 15-second line. He jumped right back in. He's from like somewhere in Pennsylvania. He talks a whole faster than I do. And he was jumped right on there, said, yeah, in the Philippines, I'd be a billionaire. I'd be a way more than a billionaire. And he started talking about all this. The guy went on and on. He's got a $16,000 water fountain in his front yard that got struck by lightning, and he was saying how the insurance had covered it. And he was telling me all about that and telling me how he's got different lights for the seasons in it and all this. And does all of this material wealth and prosperity, brothers and sisters. There's nothing wrong with that. But this guy was just bragging it up like I said, a 16-year-old that just, you know, that had a Corvette or something. I mean, it was just unbelievable. I mean, I couldn't believe this guy was just so boastful about all of his stuff. I mean, like I said, if I'd met him in the street somewhere, I would say the guy was probably crazy. He was lying. This guy's lying. But no, I mean, I was at his house. And it's true. Obviously, what all he was saying. And then the thing is that he wanted $1,000 over the actual value of his vehicle, and even got mad when I told him, you know, well, this is the value of it. He got mad about it and just raising Cain with me. And so this guy, and even I even told him, you know, I had the orphanages in the Philippines, like I said. I gave him that one line, told him I was going to drive it around, and then he saw I was driving the other van. Now, the Kelley Blue Book value on the van I'm driving is a 2012 Honda Odyssey EX. It's like the highest one. The private sale value is $24,000. So he asked me, oh, the owner, I told him that, you know, my friend is letting me borrow this van and she needs it back, so that's why I'm trying to buy a minivan. And he said to me, he said, oh, she don't want to sell you that one. I said, well, yeah, she wanted to sell it to me, but I just don't, you know, want to go get a loan and spend $24,000. You know, I don't want to waste that money. I can get a cheaper one that's pretty reliable. His had like almost 130-something thousand, almost, I think, 133,000 miles on, which is a lot for a Chrysler, right? It's not a Honda, it's a Chrysler, and a Dodge, they don't last that long. Anyway, and he took me for a ride in it, and he drove. I didn't test drive it, he drove it around the golf course there. And anyway, so I was just quiet, just like the guy, if you've been watching my videos, like the guy in Seattle, who I spent days and days and days ministering to, and then when I was getting ready to leave, you know, I'd made the mistake of trusting in that God had sent people who were wealthy, we could build some orphanages. That's what I'm thinking the whole time. Of course, I'm ministering to this brother, but I'm thinking, hey, you know, the Lord's connected me with these people that are so wealthy that, you know, this guy could give the money to build, to buy the land and build an orphanage, the whole packet, like 30, 40 thou, he could give that, and that's just like $40 to me. You know, the guy had a riding around on a private jet, driving a Maserati, so in Seattle. So, but then when I got ready to leave, I found out that he wanted me to turn the ministry into a business and start setting up some kind of a communal and selling American priced, selling the land and building houses for rich Americans in the Philippines at American price, at the price they would expect, and selling them food at the price they would expect. In other words, scam all the rich people in the States, get money from that, you know, to support the orphanages and myself. That was his idea. So just like this guy, wanting $1,000 over the value of the van, what I understand is most of the people who are wealthy, not all, but it's really true what Jesus said, because they've done people wrong in lots of cases and been ruthless toward other people to get where they're at. Now, I'm a pro-capitalist, but there's, you know, you can still maintain your Christian values, like Chick-fil-A, they close on Sunday. You know, this Hobby Lobby, you know, they stood their ground about not wanting to supply medical insurance for abortions and stuff. They said they'd pay for birth control pills, but they didn't want their employees to have the morning after pill and all this kind of stuff, abortions and all that. So you can still stand your ground and serve the Lord, and God will bless you. As a matter of fact, people talk lots of junk about Rockefeller. John D. Rockefeller is the richest man to live in the history of the world after Solomon. You know, he was in modern day money. I think Rockefeller's worth like all those top 100 list all combined, John D. Rockefeller's worth. John D. Rockefeller was a serious Christian, and he's quoted as saying, even though their family's supposed to be part of the Illuminati and all that now, John D. Rockefeller said that the secret to his wealth was he tithed. He's quoted as saying that. He tithed. And he was almost killed in a train crash. He survived that, and he really thanked the Lord for that all of his life. Just when he was really becoming famous, when he was meeting with the railroad tycoon, I think it's Carnegie, the one who built Grand Central Station in New York. They were supposed to meet, and he was supposed to be on a train. And he just barely missed it. The train crashed. All the people were killed. The Lord spared him, and he believed that the Lord spared him, and he honored the Lord all of his life for that, and tithed, and that was, he said that was the secret to his wealth. The richest man that ever lived, as I said, after King Solomon. And go look at John D. Rockefeller's wealth in modern dollars, in constant dollars. Anyway, brothers and sisters, then after I left that guy, and I was just stunned, I was shocked, I wasn't upset like I was with a guy in Seattle, because this guy, you know, I never, you know, I wasn't working with him and wasn't talking to him. I tried to talk to him about the Lord. I couldn't get nothing in. I wasn't hurt or anything like that, like I was with the other rich people I've dealt with. But I was just, like, it's sad. It's just, how can you be so wealthy and be so ignorant and so dumb? That's what I was thinking. Just so self-absorbed and so silly and immature and foolish. It's just foolishness. You know, there's nothing wrong with having things, but there's one thing of being thankful and grateful and humble with what you got, and there's another thing to be arrogant and boastful and bragful. You know, but anyway, so I left this guy, and I know the Lord is still teaching me the lesson, you know, not to look to people to provide, but God will provide for Joshua's ministry. Look, brothers and sisters, we if I don't have the money, we can't do the feedings. I mean, there's 500 plus kids that eat when I have the money, and I don't, you know, I'm not going to come on here and beg for money, you know, to make the budget for the orphanage. So, you know, as the Lord is teaching me a lesson to rely on Him and walk by faith, you know, it's up to Him. If He wants it to go forward, He's got to make a way. It's the Lord's orphanage, the Lord's feedings, all that stuff. You know, that's all I can do is rely on Him. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I left this guy who could have given me the van, but I didn't say he had to, but he could at least sold it to me at the value. So I left this dude, and I even thought, well, maybe his wife has a heart. Maybe he'll tell his wife, you know, and then she might say, well, you ought to give it to him. He's a missionary, you know. He's got these orphanages, you know. But I knew it wasn't going to happen. So, you know, the Lord knows. So I left there, and I went to these other people's house, brothers and sisters, and they were poor people. And I didn't know that in advance these people were rich and who was poor. I showed up at these other people's house. The girl, the woman, is like in her early 30s. She's from here. She went to the same high school I did. She's about 10 years behind me. And then she's living with a guy. Her boyfriend is from Wisconsin. And they just moved back here from California. I guess her parents died and she inherited this house. But it's an old house. You know, they're lower middle class, I will say. And they're definitely not wealthy. And they, you know, just your average people to lower middle class. And she has this 2003 Honda van, minivan, that's worth probably about $3,000 or $3,500. But it's kind of ragged out. They have lots of kids and there's all this food stains in there and all this stuff. But it just needs to be clean, and it needs new tires and this, that, and the other. And so she said she would take $1,800 for it. You know, that's the minimum she could take. And she told me, brothers and sisters, listen to this. She said, if you don't buy it, because they've been trying to sell it a few weeks, and they took it to CarMax, they offered them $1,300 for it, or something like that. And she told me, $1,200 or $1,300. She told me, you know what I'm going to do? If you don't buy it, and nobody buys it in the next week or so, I'm going to give it to a misfortunate family here in this area. She's going to give it away to unfortunate people, you know, somebody that don't have any money. And this woman is not wealthy herself. She, like I said, she's lower middle class. And she's going to give it away. Now, neither one of these people were Christians, you know, and then this woman is going to give it away to people. You see what I mean? That is the world, brothers and sisters. That's what we deal with every day. That's what I deal with every day. And that is what the Lord is talking about. And so that's why it's really so true. It's easier for a camel to fit through the eye of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And then as far as poor people go, of course, Jesus said we would always have the poor with us. These people weren't really poor, but by Filipino standards, they were upper middle class. But by American standards, they're lower middle class. So people don't know that or think about those things in their life. Most people, you know, they don't care. You know, they're going along with their life and you know, they're living their life. They have kids and whatnot. So anyway, brothers and sisters, the place that we need to be is trying to win people to the Lord. And that's what it's all about, brothers and sisters. I've been talking for a long time. I want to cut this video off. And I've got some more messages that the Lord gave me to make.